So let's get back. I'm gonna now what we are going to do is to do proton experiments. So this morning it's all about direct DNP on like proton DNP, and this afternoon we will see how we transfer the polarization to carbon spin with CP. And we'll be using the sample that you have prepared yesterday and put in the polarizer. And the sample has spent the whole night in the polarizer in the liquid nitrogen. There will be a lot of repetition with what Sami has said this morning, and I think it's good because I don't think it is particularly straightforward what he explained. But now I will present things in slides and directly show them live. Probably a first thing to do before doing any experiment or talking about the experiment is check that our that we have liquid helium, because all the experiments we do, we always want the sample to be in liquid helium. Even cold gas would not do the job for several reasons. As soon as it is in gas and not in liquid, the temperature is not so certain. You will switch on microwave irradiation, it will go super hot very rapidly, and also CP will not work because they will be arcing. So we want to check that we are in the liquid, and this morning I did a refill. And these lines that you see here, they represent the sensors. So now you see that two sensors are in liquid helium and one is out of helium. Basically what we want to do is just make sure as we are working that at least one of the sensors is always in liquid helium. So once in a while, I will go back to this interface, check that the sensors are in helium so that it is safe. So if I forget to do it, just please say, hey, check the helium. And I will be showing many things, explaining stuff, and probably do many mistakes. So if you think that I've explained that I would use one or another parameter, and when you see me typing, you see something else, of course, say, I think this is wrong. And even if you were wrong, then it will be an occasion to check it. So I really encourage you to interrupt me, to ask questions, and to tell me I think you're wrong, because it will probably be the case often. One comment here, the pressure is 700 millibars, which corresponds to a temperature that you see here of 3.8 Kelvin. So as Sami explained, this is the temperature that we use to do our thermoequilibria. So about high gamma, the DNP on high gamma nuclei, I'm going to first talk about how we record a thermoequilibrium. This is what Sami showed earlier. A few reminders about protons and how they behave. They have a T1 about a few minutes at 3.8 Kelvin and ours at 1.2 Kelvin or 1.6 Kelvin. That's why we will record it at 3.8 Kelvin. It's more convenient. The T2 is super short and we have a super high sensitivity. That's why we can afford to use small angle pulses instead of like standard 90 degree pulses. So we will detect the DNP buildup in a single run, and at every 5 seconds, we will record 64 scans with 0.1 degree. So here we first saturate the spins with a train of 90 degree pulses, and then this repetition time here is 5 seconds. Every 5 seconds, we will do 64 scans and average 64 scans of 0.1 degree. Yes? This we can have a look. It depends on how the sequence is coded. So let's have a look at this. I think it is on the order of a few milliseconds. So let's go to top spin and let's have a look at the pulse sequence that we use to do this. I'm going to close the spooler. So here I have prepared the sequence. If you don't see well, I suggest you come closer, because this is really important. Yeah? No, no, no. It is really homemade. I can zoom. But it will be very, if I zoom, then I will really struggle to know what I'm doing. Yeah. So I would say come closer. We could even bring the screen a little closer, no? Okay. We can also have a look at the graphical version. Yeah, yeah. No, because I see everything here. I see exactly the same. So this pulse sequence here has a saturation block. You see a pulse on the proton channel, on the carbon channel, and it's repeated 30 times. Then here you don't see it, but we switch on or not the microwave radiation. So that's what I showed yesterday, is to switch on microwave radiation. Where is it? Here, we decide to switch on or not switch on the microwave radiation. You don't see it on the diagram here. And this is the block that does the 64 scans, and then we wait sometimes. So you see this whole block is, it should be 5 seconds, and the remaining time here is 4.74 seconds. So it means that the detection block is 25 milliseconds. But in fact, it's because it is so long because here we have this 1 millisecond delay, and we could get rid of this. It would be faster. Yeah, it's a detail. Let me check my program. So this is the pulse sequence. As I said yesterday, we have options in our sequence. So for example, not all of them are useful here, but the most important, for example, is this one, is the saturation. So if we were at the sat option, if we want to activate it, we have to write dsat here. So now it is active, and it means that because it is active, we enter this part of the sequence where we have a pulse on the proton channel, we wait 1 millisecond, a pulse on the carbon channel, we wait 10 milliseconds, and then we loop this. So loop to 4, which is here, times L1, and L1 is set to 30. So it means that we just go 30 times over a pair of pulses on proton and carbons. So we have this option on. We don't have at the moment the DNP option on because we want to record the thermal equilibrium. So because the option is not on, we go here, block microwave, and then the detection block. What we need to set, the parameters we need to set, there's the power for the saturation pulses that is set to 60 watts. The 90 degree pulse corresponding to this power, I optimized it with James on Tuesday. It's 5 microseconds, 5.25. I can show you how we do that, but we use DNP to do our nutation curves. And an important point is that it is super important not to do DNP before you want to record your thermal equilibrium. And I will show you why. Because once you do DNP, you have some polarization that you cannot kill. And it will take a very long time before you are able to record a real thermal equilibrium. So I will show you, it's quite fun to see. We use a D1 of 5 seconds, so this is the repetition time. A gain of 16. Sami said that we like to keep all parameters constant. Well, I don't. this one we change and assume that it is linear. And 64 scans. So I start. Oh, maybe last thing we could do is have a look at the WOB. Make sure that everything is fine while it's opening. Just have a look. Okay, we still have sensors in helium. We are safe. Carbon is fine. Although we are not detecting carbon, we want to make sure that it is on resonance because we have saturation pulses on the carbon. You could say it's not useful to have saturation on the carbon. We do, so we don't want to have the mistuned probe and a huge reflection that would, I mean, make the spectrometer cry. Proton is fine as well, so let's start the experiment. I didn't say this, but this is a pseudo 2D experiment, so it means that we are storing spectra after spectra in a 2D mode, So we want to do the Fourier transform in one direction. So I will use the common XF2, which only does the Fourier transform along the second dimension. This is what we get. So I can, for example, Fourier transform the last acquired spectrum. So to have a look at what it looks like. So this is our proton signal. It is, what's the breadth? It's 33 kilohertz. From my knowledge, almost 35 kilohertz. So those who prepared this sample, I suppose they have maybe put a little too much H2O, because it's supposed to be 29-30 kilohertz. In 5 years, I've prepared a lot of samples of DNP juice, and it's always this. With 50 millimolar radicals, without, you would have 20 kilohertz. Oh yeah, it could be too much radical. You're right, that's another possible explanation. A last explanation is that if you look at what happened during the night, we had a very short time here in the end of the night where the sample was out of helium. Yeah, but it's very short. Because you can think if the sample is no longer on helium, then all sort of weird thing that Sami mentioned yesterday, cold crystallization, things like this, can change a little bit the behavior of the sample. But, I mean, broader, yeah. So we'll see the how fast it is. But according to the sensor, the sample stayed at 4 Kelvin, so no risk of cold crystallization. Let's go back to top spin, if you allow me. I transform again. So now it's raising. Another thing that we like doing to check what is going on is a projection. So with a projection, we can integrate the spectra one by one and see the trace over time, which is very convenient.
Maybe you could show, with the tool, you can show all the spectra.
Yep.
What's the name of the tool? Like
MD. MD, yeah.
But it's not always clear what that is. So.
Yeah, you're right. So if you are used to 2D experiments, you know that we are looking at the spectra from the top here. This is like on a map in the mountains. What we are looking at is the contour plot. But as Sami says, it is convenient to look at it like this, so we can watch what happens over time. So we see the signal raising over time. We see that the width of the signal does not change. We are going from a polarization of zero, and it will stabilize at 0.19, which is the proton polarization at 3.8 Kelvin. And this is, we don't have significant radiation damping at this polarization, so the width remains constant. I transform again. Oh. And now I want to do a projection, so I want to I will integrate from more or less here, and I check. I cannot move my mouse to show you. You're right. So if you look, it's written at some place, column and row, and the row is 240, more or less, 238. So I want to integrate from 240 to here, which is 300, 310, more or less. So I just want to remember these two numbers when I go to proj. I want to calculate the sum of the columns from, what did I say? 200, 200 is more or less.
338,
yeah, it's a little broader. I keep it. And now this was saved in proc 999. So we see it's raising, it's not at equilibrium yet, but it's soon getting there. So this morning, before you arrived, I did this experiment, and then I did a DNP build-up. I already quantified the polarization to make sure it was behaving well. And it was behaving like I recorded a polarization of 19.5, something like this, which is, and with James on a sample prepared by James a few weeks ago, a few months ago, we recorded 19 point, or 20. So you see, sample prepared by different people behaved quite nicely reproducible, so it's cool. So I will show you how we do the DNP then, but while it's, how late am I? Yeah, 7 minutes behind, it's fine. So this is I'm recording a thermal equilibrium buildup. Let's transform it again. And now I will show you what happens. So this is what we are recording at the moment. I will show you what happens if you are a naughty operator and you do this after doing DNP. So I did this morning during the course. This is what you get. So here it's the same experiment, exact same experiment. It's just the history of what happened before that changes it. So in this case, I did a DNP buildup before, and for some reason, you cannot saturate all the spins that are hyperpolarized, maybe the deuterium, the proton. Some protons are hidden somewhere near the electron. You cannot touch them, but still they are hyperpolarized, and they will give away polarization to your protons. So I did this, then I did the experiment again. Still not right. And then again, still not really right. And then finally, in the end of the morning, we get a... So you see, I could show the timings, but at least 1 or 2 hours happened between the moment I did DNP buildup and the moment I could record again thermal equilibrium without bias. If you do the same at 1 Kelvin, you would have to wait about a day. So this is that it works at 3.8 Kelvin with this concentration of radical. Same at 1 Kelvin would be days. So Mehdi asks why we have this problem. I don't want to go too much into the details, but for a short explanation, you have protons near the electrons, and these protons are super shifted in frequency. So, and they represent maybe 5% of the sample. It's not a lot. But imagine that they are polarized at 20%. Even if you have only 20% of them, when you cannot, your pulses don't touch them, but still they can the polarization can slowly diffuse to the visible spins. So when you do the math, just like the cross product, you see that 20% polarization, but even with 5%, is still huge compared to your signal. And you can actually optimize it to see it raising like this and go down. Yeah, so the polarization on the deuterium spins can also diffuse to the proton. It was shown 2 weeks ago by people in Paris, by Bogdan. But I don't want to go too much into the details of this because this is quite specialist. But just to say it is super important to be careful with this. And it's the same with carbon. You don't want to do a thermal equilibrium after doing DNP. There's one way to do it that is very simple, is you go down at the polarizer, you take the sample, lift it, place it back. This kills the polarization because you go to low field, you're safe. So if you really need to, you can still do that. Sorry?
I can maybe click so you don't have to worry about this.
Yeah, that's really kind of you. So I think I can stop it now because I have recorded it this morning and we have it. But to show you where we got in these few minutes, if I transform it again. Oh. Tell me if I should go slower. So now we are there. So we can now do the DNP. I'm supposed to go to my... Yeah, supposed to go to my slides. Yeah?
Could you show how those...
I will do that a little later. That's the end of that's the plan for the end of the morning. Yeah. So now to record the same thing but with microwaves on, so DNP. It's more or less the same what we're going to do. The timings, it's also in the order of a few minutes, but we have now an extreme sensitivity, a super huge signal. Sami mentioned that one of the reasons why we need to use so small angle pulses is that if we were to use 1 degree pulses, even with the lowest gain, we would still saturate the receiver. That's with 0.1 degree and a gain of 0.25, we'll be fine. So this only thing I will change to do DNP, except switching on microwaves, is changing the gain. But looking at how good the signal is here, we could also say, well, we could use also a gain of 0.25 and not change anything, as Sami said. Someone here mentioned to me yesterday, oh, but you say you changed the gain. Are you sure it's linear? And that would be good to check.
Yeah. This was checked by Booker during the installation.
Okay.
With what they call Corta procedure.
Okay.
So we trust them, but we never really check. So we could do this, do the same, repeat this experiment with different gain and see if it's consistent.
Yeah.
I think we did it at some point. But we didn't trust so much. But you were doing it again.
Okay, I'm going to copy this experiment, remove the saturation, change the gain to 1, stop it, start it again, and we will check immediately. Oops. I do the projection. Overlay it with the previous one. Now this is, I have to increase it by 16. Oh! Go back! Congratulations, Brooker. So let's have all these papers are correct. So enough with this. Now what we want to do, I stop this one, is we're going to copy this experiment, and we are no longer going to do a thermal equilibrium, but we are going to do some DNP. Do you remember what I have to change if I want to do DNP? Yeah. So I will write DNP. That's one option. I removed one option here also. It was DSAT. You prefer to start from 0. And I said I wanted to put the gain to 0.25. There's another thing I should do. If
set the power.
Yeah, I have to set the parameters of the microwave. Of course, because I did DNP this morning, they are already set, but we are going to look at them together. Here, this frequency, 1, 2, 3, 4, 8, or if you prefer to see it after multiplication, it's 197,600 megahertz. This is our optimum frequency for positive DNP at 3.8 Kelvin with 50 millitemple in DNP juice. And with a modulation of 10 megahertz, after multiplication it's 160 megahertz, it's quite broad. And it's not super sensitive, you can go from a 5 to 10, it will more or less give the same, it will be exactly the same. And the power is set to 140 milliwatts, so that's the maximum power that we have available. And this program is pretty much independent from Topspin, so Topspin doesn't know what I said here. Topspin can only send a TTL trigger to the AMC to switch off the microwave, but not interact with these parameters. So now I have everything ready. I can launch the proton DNP experiment. Yeah?
It is 10 kilohertz or kilohertz?
It's 1 kilohertz. It would make a little more sense to use, I mean, as you saw the plots. Sami said it was decreasing, And in fact, it's the line that you added on the top of the points that were decreasing. The points were not decreasing that much, I think.
Yeah.
It's really, there's no reason to think it would. Maybe your microwave source is not able to keep up. That could be a reason, but I think it's able to do it. Okay, so let's frame for me. How am I with time? Start DNP, set microwave parameters. I'm nearly on time. Maybe I'm talking too fast, so you have to pull me. So far, what we see is not very different. I can transform the last spectrum that was acquired. So this is a DNP spectrum. I can overlay it with a thermal equilibrium spectrum. You see already a little bit of broadening. So this is radiation damping kicking in. And so far, we don't have a lot of polarization. So after a while, it will become really broad. And you see also that we have an increased sensitivity. We have less noise, obviously, even with weak gain. So while it is equilibrating, I think I can explain a little bit how we want to quantify the polarization after that. Yeah, I forgot to tell you that the only difference is that we switch on microwave to do DNP. So going back to what Sami explained, but here I'm really giving the minimal information, the one that we will use to quantify. We don't measure polarization. What we measure is signals, and the ratio of signals gives us an enhancement. So the first thing we can really, the most direct thing that we can measure is the ratio between the signal, and this is the enhancement. We don't use the signal intensity because it's more biased than the signal integral, even more so with radiation damping. So we want to have these two integrals and compare them. We will have to take into account gain and things like this, which will come a bit later. And once we have this enhancement, we can multiply it by the thermal polarization that we know from Boltzmann law, that is written here. I don't think I need to say too much about it because this is Sami told you a lot about it. But the typical values are here for protons at 3.8 Kelvin and 7.05 Tesla. It's 0.19%. If you are interested, I can give you. I have written because I told you I'm obsessed with not doing the same task two times. I have this function where I write which spin it is. One is proton, 13 is carbon-13. The field and the temperature, and it gives me the polarization. If I wanted percent, it would be this. So if you're interested, I can give you these functions. You can also type things like this to have little things that are useful to have when you are doing experiments. So now I suppose it should be more or less at equilibrium. So yes, it is at equilibrium. So it means that I can transform a spectrum, the last one, number 50, and I go too fast, I'm sorry. I'm doing EFP to transform one of the spectra out of all the one that's pre-recorded. Here I have the list. It tells me I can do from 1 to 52, 52 being the most recent one. So I take this one and I save it in a proc number 10. And then the proc number 10 appears here. So this is my spectrum. I will do the same with the thermal equilibrium. Because I don't remember when I did when I transformed it, I do it again. I will take the last one, 138, and save it in 10. So this is my thermal equilibrium, and this is my DNP spectrum. The way I quantify the I will compare the integral is I use top spin function to integrate. By default, I always go from 1,000 to minus 1,000, just to keep it consistent. Now I save it, and the reference integral for one corresponds to this. I go to the hyperbolic signal, I do the same, and then I click right-click use last scale for calibration, and it tells me that I have 1.2510. The number here is 1.6510. So let's write it here, 1.6510. So this is the ratio of the integrals. So it means that I have an enhancement of 1.6, which does not look great, but why is it so? No, it is at the same. Yeah, the gain. So one gain is 16, and the other one is 0.25. So I need to correct by the ratio of the gains, and then this is my real enhancement, 105. And then I can, to have the polarization, I just multiply this number by the polarization of the proton spin at thermal equilibrium, and we get 20%. Exactly what James and I measured on Tuesday in our reference experiment. So I don't know who prepared the sample, but maybe Charlotte cheated you and took. Cool.
Yeah.
It's really nice.
The relaxations are similar.
So yeah, let's have a look at this. This is interesting. I'm going to transform again to have a bit more data points. So this.
Just to be clear, it's positive
for
this frequency, it's not negative,
whatever. Oh, yeah. You mean the DNP we are doing?
Yeah.
Yeah, I said negative?
Yeah.
Okay, it's positive. And maybe because now we are safe, we know it's working well with the positive, with the reference we did the other day. When we go to 1 Kelvin, we can go negative and see the 100% polarization.
Can I ask you one thing?
Yeah.
Did you already notice a change in line width?
Yeah.
It's 20% polarization. Oh, you already showed it.
Yeah, but not in the end. So here.
You can maybe superimpose them.
Yeah.
So it's getting broader because it's a positive.
By the way, don't. Don't be afraid if you see this. Now, if you open the WOB, you will see a very funny effect. So, it's also important not to think that you have killed your spectrometer. So, this is your NMR signal that is so broad that it is seen by the WOB. So. Because the WOB, you are making small pulses and seeing what comes back. And in fact, you are seeing an NMR signal because it is so broad. It's so strong. It's just that in normal NMR experiment, you also see it, but it's this. So now if we can measure relaxation looking at this thing, I think I almost see it decaying. But so if you want to WOB again, you just have to saturate your spins and you can do what you have to. So we wanted to see if the sample behaves similarly as what James and I saw the other day. So I'm going to open the DNP buildup at 3.8 Kelvin, the same condition, same everything. Ah, yeah, I think it's probably. I will do the projection again. Maybe I use different parameters for projection, which could explain this. Yeah, okay. So it was just a projection that was calculated differently. So you see, we have in your sample, we have slightly less signal. Maybe it is the pipetting things doesn't mean a lot because I saw more or less the same difference on the thermal equilibrium. But this is the DNP buildup for your sample at 3.8 Kelvin and James's sample on Tuesday in the same conditions. And yours is going just a little faster. And because it's a little broader, this speaks in favor of having a little too much radical. More than too much protons. Because, yeah.
If you compare this rate to thermal buildup, is it the same?
Yeah, let's have a look. I think it is. From what I've seen. Oops. What's this? Oh, no, I'm not. Wrong experiment. Thermal equilibrium. XF2. Garage. I just want to make sure I'm comparing integrals that where I projected with the same parameters. So this is your sample, and this is James's. No, everything is not completely consistent. You have a bit more signal, and you are going slower. Ah, no, sorry, it's the opposite. You are going faster again and lower.
Yeah, and they build up, or DNP build up.
They were behaving exactly the same.
We
had the same differences. So it really seems like a little bit more radical. So it goes faster, and we lose signal during the dead time, and it broadens the line. So the three symptoms speak in favor of... Oh, it could be that the sample we used with James had not enough radicals. I don't want to blame you. It's one or the other.
How DNP build-up compares to thermal build-up?
We can have a look at this. Oh, okay, now I know what you wanted to see. You wanted to see this. We have the effect of the gain. So this one, the green one, which is the thermal equilibrium, is artificially high, which helps us comparing them. And you see it's a little, DNP is a little faster than relaxation, normal relaxation. It's just due to the electron polarization, in fact.
So you remember, in the first lecture, we saw that the main relaxation mechanism was the free spin process, which is exactly the same without DNP and with DNP. The only difference is the gradient of polarization and the alignment change. So the only parameter that matters here in terms of speed is this, 1 minus P squared. Mm-hmm. But at 3.8 Kelvin, the electron polarization is already 80%.
85%.
So when we saturate, it goes down maybe to around 60%, 50%. So there's a difference that translates into a different build-up time.
So from this, you can calculate electron polarization.
This would be a little tricky way to, because you have many other elements that influence it. We could try to correlate. I think I tried and it didn't work. There must be other things that enter the calculation, but you can look at T2 relaxation and correlate it with 1 minus P squared very well. I can show data later if we have time. So now, okay, I'm showing the slides after I did it, so it's a bit stupid, but this is a reminder. So the way we quantify polarization is the enhancement of the times the polarization at thermal equilibrium, and we take the ratio, the enhancement is the ratio between the integrals. And what I'm showing here, which is like, it's going from this step to this one is really stupid. But what I wanted to show is why we can keep the same thermal equilibrium to compute the polarization also at 1.2 Kelvin. We are still comparing with 3.8 Kelvin. It's because what we want to know is more is this is. This is like the ratio between signal and polarization. It doesn't care about temperature. As long as the sensitivity of your NMR system is the same, we are, by measuring the thermal equilibrium signal at a known polarization, we are measuring and calculating this signal per polarization, whatever the temperature. That's why we'll be able to keep afterwards the same thermal equilibrium. And I did not take into account the scans to quantify the polarization simply because I did not change it. And in this formula, you see that I assume that the signals are proportional with the number of scans, which is correct if you have 64 scans at 0.1 degree. We can have a look at this. So if I do 0.1 degree pulses, converted to reagents. If you take the cosine of this, this is what is left after the pulse, so you don't see any difference. If I take 64 scans, this is what I get. And if I were to measure, let's say, 64 times 64 scans, I only lose 1%. So you really see that before our pulses become starts to significantly affect the signal, you can really pulse a lot. So I can just neglect any effect of the pulses. So now that we have done all this, we want to repeat the same experiment, almost the same, because we're going to do negative DNP, but at 1 Kelvin. And this will take a lot of time, and I did not respect my plan because I wanted to start this earlier. I'm going to decrease the pressure to go to... I'm going to use more or less the parameters that Sami mentioned yesterday. I like to be gentle with the system. So I'm going to 80 millibar, doing a ramp where every 10 seconds I change the pressure by 10 millibars. Yeah. Because, oh, that's a very good question. At 1.17 Kelvin, liquid helium becomes superfluidic, which is a crazy effect. And at this point, you have a max, like the heat capacity not the heat capacity, the energy to, I don't remember the name in English, the energy to make it go to the gas phase, like goes to a maximum. So when you are, this for solid evaporation.
Sublimation, yeah. I think, from solid to gas.
Yeah, what I wanted to say is from liquid to gas, evaporation energy.
Evaporation, yeah.
It becomes super strong, so we are evaporating helium to decrease the temperature, and as we cross this point, then we are going to consume a lot. So at this point, I will put a ramp even lower. I will maybe use 2 or 5 change of millibars per 10 seconds. Yeah, but I want to change before, because let's have a look.
Shouldn't we go as fast as possible?
Yeah.
you mean
through this lambda point, through this phase change, where the latent vapor, the evaporation takes a lot of energy. Just a random question, because I don't know the answer.
But I would say you cannot make a system jump a temperature. It has to go through, no?
Yeah.
So
what's the best in terms of helium consumption? Is it to go through fast or slow?
Slow. And I have a very good answer for this.
Even if the pump is, you have the best pump in the world, should we go slow or fast?
My answer to this would be, we were using this super powerful pump, and we would run out of helium every Friday at noon. And then we got a super bad pump going slowly all the time, and we would run out of helium on a Saturday morning. So that's my very phenomenological answer.
So what is special about 3.8 Kelvin?
Why 3.8? That's a good question. Let me just finish with this, and then I answer yours. Charlotte, this is 55 millibar. And this is more or less, 80, 100. So, in fact, you're right. What is worse is just after, it's not before. So, in fact, I could go to 55 and then, yeah, it's true. Why 3.8 is we don't want to use 4.2 because we need to be under pressure to feel the VTI. So if I feel the VTI at under pressure at 700 millibars, 3.8 Kelvin, if now I want to go back to 4.2 Kelvin, I have to wait for the system to warm up. To go through...
The needle valve was closed or open?
Now it is closed, yeah.
And then does it matter?
Oh, it does. Good question. Yeah. So let's have a look at what's happening in real time. It will help. In this graph, you see... the sensor, so now one sensor is going out of helium because we are evaporating a lot of helium. In green, here's the temperature of the cryostat, which is decreasing. It's now 3.4 Kelvin. So because we decrease the pressure, I can write the pressure in also in a tensor scale. You see it's decreasing together with the temperature, and this evaporates helium. And at some point now we see this last sensor going out of helium, I think. Not yet. So at some point I will evaporate everything, so I will have to open the nevus again to be able to bring back more helium. And that's what is very painful with the slow pump, is that because everything is so slow, you consume all your helium to go down in temperature, and then you bring back more helium, so the temperature increases. So you have to go back again. So it's a sort of interplay where you have to have a bit of feeling and experience to know when to open what. While with a fast pump, you say, go to zero, fill, and it's like it burns helium, but you know precisely where you're going. So you can also see an interesting point as the phase separator temperature, which is not being displayed. Oh, it's frozen, no? Yeah, it's starting to decrease slowly here. Because I will have to refill soon, I will already increase the mass flow. So now I'm putting more flow of helium through the phase separator to start cooling it down. You see the value here, it will start decreasing. And this will allow me, once I'm running out of helium in the cryostat, the phase separator will already be cold, so I will be able to refill faster. An interesting point is also, as we are approaching this lambda point, we evaporate so much helium that goes around the phase separator that it cools it down. And we will see it very clearly here. So we will be ready to refill quite easily. It's a lot of information. There's so much going on at the same time. If you want, you can also see the parameters here. So for example, here we, because here you see the like the shape of what's happening, and here you see the real number. The temperature of the helium bath is 3.616 at the moment. How I am with time? I'm late, a little late. I think what we could do is, while it is refilling, we can have a look at the how we fit the build-ups with top spins. And then we don't want to be too late. In orange here, it's the phase separator temperature, so you see it's really going down now. Maybe I stopped being so gentle, because we don't have that much time. Okay, so that's what Charles says. We run out of helium here. So the you have a question, Mehdi?
Yes, there's a pump to reach 0 millibar.
You will never reach zero.
Yeah.
With our pump, the big one, we reach 0.65. And then I think the limitation is maybe the pump and also the insulation of the system. There's really no point in terms of DNP. 1.2 Kelvin, which is 0.65, is already a little bit of an overkill. As we have, what we have found is that 1.3, 1.4, you can have a pump that is much cheaper, but doesn't make a big difference. The question, Charlotte, is when should I open the needle valves? What do you think?
It's a question for you.
Yeah,
I mean, I will do a refill now and then go to one. I refill first and successful one and then I.
But because I'm already cold, I will lose more time. So I think I will probably play it this way. And yeah, I think I will go to sensor one, because this afternoon we will do everything at 1.6 Kelvin. And it is in the lowest position. Yeah. Let's do it like this. Okay, I stop this and I will go. Yeah, I can keep it like this. Okay. So while this is cooling down and refilling, we can have a look at how we can fit the data with the model. Yeah, I can tell you other things that I had planned to tell you before. I have quantified the proton polarization before, directly comparing the integrals, because, as Sami told you, there are no protons here and there are no protons in the coil either. So it's very convenient. We don't have to make an extra measurement to record the background. If we were to use this sample cup, which is peak and fully protonated, we would have a signal from the cup that is 10 times or 50 times that of the sample. So no way you can quantify polarization. So we always use this. And on this slide, you see what we used to have, the background in orange here, in the coil before we modified the design to remove the coil holder. So we had to record it and then subtract it, while now it's just very clean. We'll see that for the carbon, we have to remove it, and it's a bit painful because it takes 2 hours to record because of the long T1. And now what I want to tell you about the models we can fit to the data. You cannot fit all them on Topspin. I will show you tomorrow. I think it's tomorrow. Or this afternoon, I don't remember. How we can use MATLAB and a code that we have to do that in an automated way where it exports in the end the Excel file with all your experiments, the T1s and things like this. But essentially with Topspin, you can have a quick look at a mono-exponential buildup. So this function, it starts from zero, so it's the function for saturation recovery with some time constant here. I wrote T, not T1 or tDNP, because it depends what experiments you are doing, if it is a thermal equilibrium or DNP buildup, but the function is the same. And it goes to some value at infinity. But this, as you will see, does not fit the data well. That's why it's not mono-exponential. It is. It can be bi-exponential. For example, if you have a system with two phases, because you have DNP in one phase and then diffusion in the other one, so you would have two time components, x being the weight of each component. But what fits our data the best? And there's only one extra parameter, beta, is a stretch exponential buildup. So this function, very similar to this one, it is equal if beta equals 1. And beta has to be between 0 and 1. The weaker beta, the more you have, the broader the distribution of time constant you have in your system. And in our case, we have beta on the order of 0.9, you will see later. And this fits the data very well. There's just one thing that you have to have in mind, is that now this time here is not really informative. It's more interesting to use at the average time. So from mathematically, you can show that if you have this function, it corresponds to a distribution of time constant, and the average of this distribution is given by this formula. So it's really important to use this average time, because this T is not very informative. So now we'll just have a look at how we can fit this one to the data using Topspin, and those ones we'll see with MATLAB. In the meantime, just have a look at what's happening here. So now we see you see the phase separator. I'm making it blink. It got to a low value, 4 Kelvin. So now we are really bringing liquid helium to the system. And since then, it made two of the sensors go in liquid helium already. So it means that we are refilling. And once the sensor 1, which is far above, it will take a while before it's in the liquid. Once it is in liquid, the refill will stop, and I will make it go lower in pressure, to go lower in temperature. To fit the time constant on Topspin, we use a module of Topspin, T1, T2. There are several ways you can use it. It's a little fiddly, so I have the way I use it, I always do the same, then I don't do mistakes. So what I do is I transform the highest intensity signal And now I will integrate this signal dot int to open the integration module. I'm gonna erase. I don't know how what I should do to make sure I erase this integral, and I will integrate again. Sorry, not correct the baseline. I mean, you see, as compared to the signal, how close to zero it is, and this is what this foot here. I think it is signal, because we have a void. We have the convolution of a. Yeah, I have to make a choice at some point. What I could do is have a larger spatial window. And have it large enough that I know that I'm on the baseline on the sides, and I will probably gain a 1 in 1,000 improvement in my. I think it will not be. We could check. Yeah. You're right. Let's do that.
And what's really clear is that when you remove the sample, the baseline is
like 3%.
Yeah, it was 3%. Okay. But I'm losing the 3% on all the signals.
Yeah.
That's why I always choose the same integration boundary. And anyway, radiation damping makes it even more wrong. So
yeah,
what we are talking about is...
It's changes you need to integrate the different regions.
Yeah, so...
You have a background?
Of this one? No, because it's a line, as you say. It's a flat, completely
but
flat
it's
line.
It's centered on zero.
Yeah.
From what I remember, so... Everything like pointing the direction of like indicating that this is real signal. These are just spins that are very much shifted because of the electrons or because just it's not the line shape, but it's real.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So now, before saving and closing the module, I go here and I click export regions to relaxation module and return. And this has saved this region. So now when I use the integration, the T1 fitting module, it will remember this. So I click T1. Oh, no. Before opening the module, I have to go back on proc 1. This is part of the tricks you have to remember. When you open T1, T2, you must be on proc 1. And I open it now. And there's a list of things you have to do. Because I have already defined the region where I integrate, I don't need the first two. It's done by the fact that I have selected my integral and saved it. I can go to relaxation. Now it's not happy because usually when you measure a T1, you use a VD list. We don't use a VD list because we have a fixed interval. So we have to tell it. Here it's not a VD list. We have to choose auto. And then write the increment that we have between the points, which is 5 seconds, this is our D1. So this is, and we have procedures in our manual. I think the manual is here. So this is our Bible that we wrote last year. And typically, these are all I'm explaining is written in the manual. And the function type here, this one is to fit a T1. It does a job. Press OK. I change the window. So now this is the integral computed by Topspin. I prefer using areas than. I said it was in the integral. No, it was not. It was the intensity. Now it is the integral. And clicking here, it will. Wow. This is an excellent fit. So I think I have to help it a little bit. I've never seen this. This one is if you have several regions. So let's try the satvec. This is appalling. But see here, it doesn't start at zero. I always do this. I told you I always do the same so that I don't have problems, but still I have problems. So this is... Then what I usually do is close every window and start again. So, yeah, let's open this, integrate. I must say, it happens to me quite often with this module that you do the same thing two times, and once it worked, once it does not. So I don't find it too shocking so far. I just have not to stress in front of you. Auto 5. So it's still not starting at 0. So what we can do instead is use like the approach of a physicist of the 60s, rather. But this usually works. It does not take the spectra where you have zeros. It discards them. So that's why I'm really confused. But what we want to do now is just have a rough ID. So to have a rough ID, I like doing this. You take, it won't be visible I can take the probe to do this. It's not very nice for the probe, but it's too long anyway. So I can take the slope here until here, so it crosses here, go here, and this is your T1.
You should
You take the 2/3 value, so you could cross the number 10 line.
Yeah, so it's
around here.
Yeah, number 10 line. So it's the 6 index, and 6 times 5 seconds, so it's 30 seconds T1. It's not very clean way to do it, but. And also because it's stretched exponential, this is biased. Because in a stretched exponential, the slope is bigger. So it gives us... Sorry. Let's have a look at the cooldown in the meantime. So now it's filled. I need to tell it to go to 0 millibar now with a gentle ramp. And go slowly to avoid burning helium for nothing. And I think we can go for lunch. And I will launch the build-up later once it's cooled down. I will just show you, before we go to lunch, how we will set the parameters for the DNP. I'm just going to also write here what parameters I use. So it was positive DNP. I use a frequency of 1, 2, 3, 4, 8. Oops. I have to close any desk, I have a bug. So we did the positive at 3.8 Kelvin and we will do the negative at 1.6, just to show you, to be very proud of showing you a polarization above 1. I have a problem. Now I have no correspondence between the keyboards.
Have a keyboard selection on the top, right?
Where? Let's see what this does. No, now I'm on French keyboard with a Swiss one in front of me. So I will write the names later. I will just create the... Of course, even this doesn't work now. It's very painful. Okay, so most importantly, we should change the value here to 1, 2, 3, 8, 2. That's the optimal frequency for the negative DNP. I'm gonna get out of the like switch off my screen, my my keyboard, and go away, not to interfere. It worked.
Yeah.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, 8, 2.
Modulation.
And modulation will be 5 megahertz. So it's the spectrum is not is a little sharper on the negative side. So we use a sharper modulation. And that's it. So with this, instead of positive DNP, we'll do negative DNP, and we'll have a negative signal. So we don't have much more to do to reach negative DNP. And as you can see here, while we are talking, the pressure is stuck here at 2.17, which is exactly the lambda point. So this is where, if we open this guy, you see that the temperature when it's going down, and at 2.17 is a sort of plateau, because this is really where we are hitting this transition here. So physics is conserved. And in about 10-15 minutes, it will be at a stable temperature at around 1.6 Kelvin, and I will switch on the experiment.
Would you like me to do what you were about to do in the speed?
Oh, it was just changing the names. I can do it afterwards. It's fine. All fine? You have questions before we go to lunch?
Positive, you had modulation of 60 megahertz.
It was 10 times 16, so 160. Maybe it's a little...
Ah, yes, and now you have
5 times 16, so 80 megahertz. But these are values we optimize once, and it's so unsensitive.
But you usually, like, see that for negative, you use different values.
Yeah. The negative optimum is a bit narrower, so you have using the less modulation breaths to get the optimum. And you have to be very careful with this value, because depending on the groups, they use plus or minus that delta, or there is delta as the full modulation breath. Even us, we're not consistent in our notation, because we used to have a device in the past where it was like plus or minus, and now with the blooper system, it's the full breadth. So we used to have like 80, now it's 160, simply because of the definition of the modulation frequency.
I find the breadth more intuitive, because you see what you cover on the on the spectrum.
Okay.
I can tell you, while we were eating, so just before eating, we refilled the cryostat. Here you see the opening of the needle valve, and then closing because it was full. Here you see the helium sensors, one of them going in helium, then the next one, later this one. And then evaporation starts, and after a while, one sensor gets out of helium. And slowly over time, they all went out of helium, meaning that there's no more helium. So I've started a refill again. That's what you see here. I've opened a needle valve. This is the mass flow that I've increased. And then we see it's sort of going up and down, because we are bringing helium at 4 Kelvin, but the system is at 1.6 Kelvin, so it will move a little bit and then go back in temperature. So while this is refilling, we can have a look at what happened. So this is the build-up. I can transform it now that it's finished. It's green, because blue means positive and green means negative in the convention of top spin. So it's good. It means that we have indeed done negative DNP. I'm going to transform the last spectrum, 256. And you see a negative signal. It's not very convenient to work with negative signals, so I'm going to phase just inverting it for convenience. So now you see the signal. And you may notice, because we have intense radiation damping, now the signal is much sharper than before. I can overlay it with the positive DNP that we did earlier. The effect is quite clear. And it is so narrow that we don't have enough points in the Fourier transform. So I'm going to change the parameters of the Fourier transform. Oh, I forgot to change the phase, I think. Save in 2D. Yep. And now, so instead of, I will increase the number of points in the Fourier transform by 4. Also, we always apply line broadening, so I had a kilohertz of line broadening. Let's have a look at what happens if I don't apply line broadening and having more points. And then I'm going to use the multi-display mode to show you a long time what happens. So we see the signal increasing and getting narrower. I'm going to transform again the last one with this new these new parameters. And you see here little wiggles. If we have a look at the FID, this is no wonder. So these are all the FIDs one after the other. Now what happens is that we truncate the FID because it gets so long with radiation damping that our parameters, they are not really optimal to look a signal that is so long. And about the width of the signal, it's it's 7.5 kilohertz. We started with 33 kilohertz and now it's 7.5. So there's a massive effect of radiation damping. I also wanted to show you, to make it a little clearer, why this messes up the integral. So these are examples of proton DNP positive and negative mode, where you see the polarization of over time, and the polarization is going above 100%. And for these two experiments, I have also plotted the change in full width at half maximum of the signal. So you see that as the time goes on, the negative signal it goes narrower, and the positive signal it gets broader. And why this effect on the signal width affects the integral? That's what Sami explained earlier, but here you see a visual explanation. In blue, it would be the signal without radiation damping. This is not a measurement or simulation, it's just I put a Gaussian or anything that looked like an FID. And we have a dead time, and we only measure the signal after the dead time. The integral of the Fourier transform is proportional to the intensity of this point. If the radiation damping broadens your signal artificially, it decreases this point. Or if it sharpens your signal, it increases this point. And this is where you have a bias in the integral. We have a strong bias in the integral because of this. Now it will be interesting to compute the polarization. So I go back to my experiment here that I used for polarization quantification. I just open and save again the integration module so that Topspin knows I want this to be my reference for the one. I go to the hyperpolarized signal, integrate it. I still use the same boundary, but now it's not so useful to go so broad, but anyway, let's be consistent. And use last scale for calibration. Now I have 6.66. I go to MATLAB again. Oops, here. And I can use this formula again. It's because all parameters are the same. 6.66. I still have I had a gain of 16 for the thermal equilibrium experiment and a gain of 0.25 for the hyperpolarized experiment. Oh, 80%, that's a bit deceiving. I thought we would have a number above above 100. That's life. Okay, so any questions about how we did this? And do you want to know anything else before we move to the carbon experiments? Last thing I could say about this radiation damping, if your probe if you have the same sample volume, the same proton concentration, and your coil does not change, is not repaired, the quality factor of the coil does not change, and radiation damping, it is proportional to the quality factor, the amount of protons. And so if you find a way to compensate it, then you can still, if you know that 80% means 70, then it will be the same all the time. But whenever we repair the probe, this will change because the quality factor will change. So it's a little hard to, that's why one of the reasons why it's hard to account for.